Hey, everybody. Hi. We're joined by Jonathan Blow. You've brought The Witness, which I understand is a video game. Yes. No, we're here to talk about The Witness. We've been talking about it in fits and starts and trying not to spoil bits and pieces of it, but it seems like, you know, we waited a little bit and we've probably warned people, like, we want to talk about The Witness. So if you're still playing The Witness, if you are yet to play The Witness and you're thinking about playing The Witness, we're looking to speak about The Witness.
Yeah, there's a massive spoiler on the screen right now, so don't cut to it yet.
I just found
until
it.
People have had the warning.
You just found this?
I just found this.
Oh,
I never came back here to
was,
see this.
I knew that this was here. Like, hours later, I was like, oh, that's totally one of them.
because that's, I mean, you know, you start in this hallway, and it's a really weird hallway, and you're like, why is it?
Yeah.
But it's designed that way to leave that question lingering, you know? Anyway, but nobody can see what we're talking about.
So if you have not played The Witness, you've been warned. You should play The Witness and come back and watch this next year or whatever.
Yeah.
All right. So you just found this thing.
I'm going to do this.
Jeez, Brad.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
I just never had occasion to come back here, you know?
Yeah.
I never really... Oh, that particle effect is my favorite thing in the game. I just love the way it hangs in the air. But yeah, I never really had a reason to come back. Like, did you expect people would come back and poke around even the starting hallway? Like, there was just so much in the game to dig into.
There is a little bit of a spatial guide to where all of those are, you know? And so you can sort of get the idea, like, oh, there's some stuff in that general direction, and that's the starting area, so maybe I should go back and investigate that.
Oh, so you would have a reason to go back, yeah.
Yeah.
I also... Man, it's pathetic.
Yeah. Oh, this one has a little more to it.
Oh,
you may not...
Oh, there's that.
Yeah, okay. So let's start at the start then. At what point did the idea for The Witness kind of come to you, and how, like, what was it fully formed, or you're like, I want an island, I want the, like, puzzles?
Yeah, it was fully formed, and I thought of it actually before Braid was done, but after all the real creative stuff had been done on Braid, and it's just the final weeks of just slogging through to get, you've got to-do lists that look like mad scribbling for pages, and you're just, you know, but that's the time, because all the creative decisions have been made, that's the time when new things can pop up. And just for some reason, enough old ideas that I've been playing around with, like, flipped in a new way. And I was like, oh yeah, this will be an awesome game to make. And I started working, so that was like 2008, that was mid-2008. Yeah. I started working on it a little bit at that time, but I still had this picture of myself as like lone game programmer designer. Mm-hmm. And it was very clearly too big of an idea, because it was like the whole idea. And I didn't think it was going to be as big as this, right?
Sure.
But I thought it was going to be a 3D game with this same basic idea that you're like solving puzzles, tracing lines, and then there's a whole bunch of secret stuff that's equal in magnitude and importance to the non-secret stuff, right? Which is not something that many games do, I think.
Right. So you didn't just start out with, like, you know, 3 dozen line puzzles that you had designed, and then think, okay, I have to find a place to stick these.
No, in fact, the secret stuff was the whole point. That was like part of the beautiful idea. It was going to be like, oh, you're going to be in a certain place, and you're going to see a certain thing, and you're going to realize it's important. And since we're getting all spoilerific, I can say exactly what that was, because I've alluded to this in interviews before, but it was pre-release, and there was no way I wanted to spoil any of this, right? But so a couple years before Braid came out, several years before Braid came out, I was working on some prototypes of some games, and one of them was like a 3D gestural spellcasting game, like Arx Fatalis or something, right? Yeah, where you would like draw the shape,
and that was
your spell. The thing that always frustrated me about those games, though, was because you were always just drawing a specific shape that meant one thing, you might as well just have a hotkey for that spell, right? Because drawing a shape is a little bit aesthetically nice, but it also just means that that's the only thing that is a chance for the shape recognizer in the code to fail, right? Like in black and white or something or whatever, right?
Yeah, you do it and you're like, I was trying to do it, but I was under duress and it went wrong and now everyone's dead.
Yeah, so the thing that I was gonna do in this game was, okay, well, there's analog properties to the shape that you make. So like you might have a little horizontal line and then it goes up and crosses over itself and then there's like a loop and the size of the loop relative to the cross or whatever could like control the parameters of your magic missile, for example, like you're trading off speed versus power versus homing with like three parameters and you could learn. So it was this idea about tracing lines, but it was very much a classical video game, like you're a wizard and you're learning spells and all that stuff.
You're fighting enemies. Like,
Then it had this one layer that made it more interesting, right? And then I was like, you know what, I'm doing Braid because that's 2D and I could do that and whatever. After that, right, I was going back to these older ideas, and I was like, what should I do next? Mm. And that came up, and so the other thing that was going to make it cool was, like a lot of these games, you know, you'd be going through a dungeon and you'd find some scroll that teaches you a thing, or you buy it in the shop, mm-hmm. and you find some scroll that like has the symbol on it that you could trace, right?
Right.
So that was, in very classic way, that was going to be how you could learn the spells. But the most powerful spells were not going to be those. There were going to be things hidden in the environment that you would have to find yourself, and that would be a big surprise when you realize, like,
together,
oh shit,
wait, that's totally
that's the thing.
One of the spells. Yeah.
Yeah. And so one of the moments that I had in my head about that game was like you're exploring and you reach the top of a mountain somewhere and you look down and like the path that you walked on to get up there mm-hmm. looked a lot like a spell shape. And if you were curious enough to try tracing that, you would learn the spell, right? That was where the whole idea for The Witness came from.
Yeah.
But at some point I decided, partially out of wanting to keep the game as simple as possible, but partially also like, okay, wait. Well, okay, so the other thing to say is I tested the spell casting a little bit, mm-hmm. and it was just too hard to learn. Like, that trade-off of the parameters is really difficult. Maybe I could try it again someday, but it wasn't really working for me game mechanically, but I was still excited about the recognizing the thing and trying it out, and that big surprise.
And I guess, like, you know, on some level, like, it seems, that seems like the sort of thing that, like, doing it with a mouse or a gamepad, like, it feels like it loses some of what makes the, like, a gestural system cool.
Yeah.
You know, you end up going down, did you ever go down the road of like, well, we need to, you know, look at motion tracking stuff, a Kinect or,
you know,
some
I thought
kind
about
of,
that
like,
a little
Wii
bit,
controller.
Or even when the iPad comes out, it's like, oh, that would be, you know, but it ended up not being even that gestural in this game, right?
Yeah.
Like there's shapes, but where you trace is actually totally constrained to those shapes.
Right.
But simply because, like you say, it's not going to feel good. If you're trying to trace over something on a gamepad, it's really hard.
Yeah. And even the, you know, the PS4's got its little touchpad thing, but that's, no one's going to use that for anything good.
But so then where this game came from then, the idea was like, okay, I'm going to take that exciting moment of being up on the mountain and seeing a thing and then tracing it and like having that expansion of your horizons, mm-hmm. right? And but if that's the really valuable thing, I don't really need all the wizard stuff, because a lot of games do that.
Sure.
Yeah. I'm going to focus down to exactly what I care about and build out from there. So mm-hmm. it's like, okay, you're tracing lines for some reason.
Yeah.
What is that reason? Okay, if it's more puzzly than you know, spellcast combat-y, what are the problems I have with puzzle games, and then how do I solve those? So I basically built this game from the ground up mm-hmm. by taking that seed of the original idea.
Yeah.
Yeah,
I am very tempted to run up to the mountain right now and show you exactly.
Illustrate. We're far from that location.
No, actually,
right
show
now.
You exactly why I totally failed to have that moment.
Well, it doesn't work for everybody, right? And at least not. And one approach to that is put enough of those moments in that maybe one of them eventually will work.
Yeah. So it seems like everyone has like a slightly different version.
That was
So
finding my first one of those. I mean, here's one right here. Was easily one of the most like profoundly like holy shit moments in this game, where I thought, oh my god, anything is possible now. Like all the rule, like it just broke its own rules. Like now, I have no idea what to expect. And talking to people after it came out, like half a dozen people came to me with different ones of those they found in the game, saying like that was their holy shit moment. You know?
Yeah. And we try, you know, there's certain ones that we feel like are easier to discover.
Sure.
Right. And we just try to make those the best ones. Right.
Right. Yeah.
And the best moments, but you don't really know what's good for individual people.
For now,
that all this said, it is very possible to play the whole game and feel like you're done. And never find any of these, and never see that whole dimension.
Or just see it and think nothing of it.
Oh, that's a little bit weird.
Oh, well, it looks a bit like the puzzles. Maybe that keys into some kind of lore thing later,
And we know for a fact that, for example, many reviewers never found that stuff. Mm-hmm. And we just let, you know, some people would make a review guide that said at the end, by the way, if you never saw these, here's A, B, and C, right? And we just didn't. I just stuck to my convictions on that. And then reviews would come out, and you can tell if they've found that stuff
really
or
found
not.
It or not. This one here, actually, the one that ends right here, ended up being one of my favorites.
That's one of the ones you have to be on the boat, I think.
So cool.
Right? Yeah. I wanted to do one that went around the whole island, like 360'd it. But it was just going to be so crazy that I felt like there were enough like that. There were enough boat things already.
I typically found you kind of wanted the boat on the slower side to make sure that you got those things right. So if you had to trace the entire island on the slower side.
What if there was a boat ride that took about 12 hours and you just had to ride on the boat and then you get the real solution?
That's right.
This one here that you're heading to actually ended up being another one of my favorites, just because it like... Was this kind of the one that you designed as like, this will be the one that it's hopefully, if we hit you over the head a little bit with it.
Yeah, this was one of the most conspicuous jumping off points, because there's this frickin' panel here,
yeah.
and it doesn't do anything,
yeah.
right? And there are other panels that seem not to do anything, but they're right. usually like a sequence, and you feel like you learned something.
Or, yeah, yeah.
This one is just like,
it's
the
easy,
hell is
you're
this?
Just like, what is this?
And, I came to it basically head on like this.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
just failed to notice the river.
That can, that's,
did
you
this.
Know, we didn't make it a glass panel. We
yeah.
could have, right?
Mm.
But
it,
we didn't.
Yeah. It apparently did nothing, and I was like, well, I must have to come back here later. And then I basically
sure.
turned like this
yeah.
and moved
yeah.
away from it, and just never, like, I failed to just do this.
Yeah.
Which, yeah.
And that, we know that that's a possibility,
yeah.
right? And so
but
there's
you're
other
right.
moments.
But you're right, there are so many of them, and some of them stand out so well that...
Yeah,
everybody ends up having their own moment.
The other key to tuning those is enough of them have to be so blatant mm-hmm. that, like, if you knew that those were a thing, you couldn't possibly miss them, right?
Right.
And the only reason you miss them is because you just don't have that tuned in,
mm-hmm.
right? And so some of those, like the Sun Temple has a giant one, or like the first view, you know, when you come out of that starting area and you come
right.
up on the hill,
yeah.
there are at least two very prominently in view right there that you can't miss. And that's just by design, because it makes those moments stronger, because
yeah.
later when you discover these things, it's not like, oh, well, okay, these are hidden very far away, so it's like, okay, it's obviously I didn't notice them. It's like,
right.
oh my God.
It's very much like
how
this
many,
hidden
wait,
plain sight
I remember
sort of
this
thing.
And that,
yeah.
yeah. And then you remember a few of them, and then you go back to earlier parts of the game, and you're mm-hmm. like, oh my God, these are everywhere.
Right.
They're like
yeah.
literally everywhere, right? Mm-hmm. And that's what makes it strong.
I actually, so not only are they everywhere, I thought it was really interesting. There are a couple, and there's one that it'll take a minute to run down there too, but there
yeah.
are a couple where there seem to be these kind of bespoke mechanics that you guys implemented just to allow you to complete one of those things.
That
and I was like,
that seems
like a disproportionate amount of work to do for a single collectible.
That's the game we're making though.
Yeah.
You know?
The one I'm thinking about in particular
in
is
here?
The cloud, the one where you have to light up the cloud. Like,
yeah.
like that's a lot,
yeah.
it seems like a lot of work for one item
you're
out of
going a little bit the wrong way for that one. There's two cloud ones. If you mean the one that you're kind of facing.
Wait, are you serious?
Really? You don't know about the other cloud?
No, I only found the one.
Okay.
Do they
Never mind. There's only one cloud one.
Okay, yeah.
So it seems like that there's, you know, one of the other joys about discussing the game with people has been seeing what people found incredibly easy versus stuff
yeah.
that really,
yeah.
really hung
totally.
Them up.
Like I the audio, well, first of all, the bamboo area of the jungle, I didn't know existed until I had already been inside the mountain. Like, I literally didn't yeah. find the yellow box in there until I had already been most of the way
well,
through the
another
end
thing, I don't know if you saw it from up on the mountain, but we intentionally designed it to be visible up there.
Really?
Like, you could
okay.
see the box.
I must have missed
it. I don't
that.
Know if very many people do that, but you can go up there and look down
and kind of get a sense
and like,
of...
okay, I see a box there that I haven't found, mm-hmm. right? And then you at least know what is around it.
But yeah,
you know,
I had a similar instance of like stumbling yeah. onto it and going, like, oh my God, there's this whole area
right.
that like I thought I had seen every specific look the game had
right.
to offer.
But
yeah.
the thing I was going to say about that area, though, was, first of all, you know, the audio puzzles there, I thought, like, were some of the most satisfying puzzles, like, and fascinating puzzles in the game.
Yeah.
And I blew through that area in, like, 20 minutes.
Same here. Yeah.
And
was,
I knew people who were just utterly stumped by that place.
Well, it's not only can be hard,
yeah.
but it also can be very irritating, because a couple of those puzzles are about really annoying you, right?
Yeah, totally. Yeah.
And if you're tired, if it's like 3 a.m. and you're still playing the game, and you hit the one with like the honky horn and
right,
the cell phone,
right, yeah.
and you're like...
Did you intend for that to be as annoying as it can be? I mean...
It's supposed to be annoying
yeah.
and disruptive, right?
Yeah,
so,
it has to get
you know,
in the way so to let you know what you're supposed to be listening
yeah.
for.
Even or, so you're within just one person, your experience with that puzzle can be very different based
right.
on what time it is and how tired you are
sure.
and whatever.
Well,
right?
See, the first time I encountered it and like... For me, the moment was you hear a bird chirping on that first
yeah.
puzzle.
Yeah.
And I had actually stopped and went, wait a minute, what the fuck is that? Okay, hang on. Are
because
you,
the game is so quiet,
yeah,
right?
It's like, okay, is there a bird? Where is the bird? Are there other people here? What, like, it was very
yeah.
much like a nature of the universe sort of moment of just like, okay, hang on a sec. Like, and then I found a speaker and went, okay.
Now I want to.
yeah. But we exactly designed for that. It was good that you, and again, not everybody's going to react that way.
Sure.
But, you know, most games you hear a bird, you're like, whatever, because the sound is like that.
Yeah,
but this game
yeah.
is really quiet. There are no living creature sounds anywhere in the game. Most
mm-hmm.
games, if you're going to do a forest ambience or whatever, you'd have little crickets
right.
or little birds in the background.
Yeah.
And then maybe the clue bird would be a louder one in the foreground. But it's like, no, completely. The audio guys had a really hard job because doing natural
sure,
ambiences
right.
without any living thing in them is very, very difficult. But thematically, we wanted you to be completely alone.
I'm trying to find that puzzle now. I know it's over this way.
Yeah, it's over. If you go in this path,
this one right, okay.
The dirt path there, yeah. And then you take the first left.
Okay.
You can actually get into it three different ways. You can get into it from that on that log from the beach, but actually,
I came into it from the
yeah. Well, you can go here, but this isn't way. Sort of the main way. But
okay.
Back here somewhere, you can hook around to the left.
Is this the first one?
Keep going to the right.
Or this, okay.
I don't know. You hook to the left here. Okay. No. Yes.
Right. Yes, that path is kind of hidden.
Okay. This is a little more hidden than the main one because it's the back way. We wanted people to come in the front way, which is over there.
I found it interesting though because obviously the game withholds so much information from you and. I solved this one without knowing why I did it because, the way that you kind of muddle through your thought process of testing things out and seeing if they work or not. I tried this randomly and it worked, and I was like, "Well, that's kind of like a serpentine shape. am I making a snake because a snake could potentially eat a bird? Like, what is going on here? And then you kind of muddle your way to the actual answer at some point.
Yeah.
But the reason I brought that up was like Jeff, you were talking about like. Sounds like both of us found this area like relatively straightforward to get through, and like I knew other people who got super hung up on it.
Some people feel like it's close to impossible.
Right, but those same people got through areas that I thought were inscrutable, like it was the back of their hand, Like it seems like different areas play to different people's intellectual strengths in really significant ways.
Yeah, and there's an interesting larger topic about this, right? That is totally true, and when you're designing a game like this, first of all, you have to understand that, because then you're a little bit more hands-off about your idea of how hard things are. Some games try to shape themselves around difficulty, like it's easy, and then gets harder, and then gets really hard, right? And then you go into playtesting or something like AAA games do, and they say, X percent of people found this puzzle super impossible. We have to take it out or make it way easier or whatever. And it's like, well, I don't like that, right? Because for me, as someone who likes to play puzzle games, it's very satisfying to have a difficult puzzle. If it's a good, if it's a crappy puzzle, it's not good, right? But if it's good, it's very satisfying. So the goal here was to make a space that was free enough that if you're stuck, you go elsewhere and whatever.
Right.
So it's non-linear. And so that audio puzzle that we were just talking about is one laser out of 11, and you only need 7 to get to the what we'll call the main ending because there's various other things.
Sure.
So if that was hard. There's some people, like people who are deaf, it's completely impossible, right? Mm-hmm. They just have to go look it up. But they can finish the game without it, right? Mm-hmm. But even people for whom that's difficult, you don't need to do it. And the game is designed that way. But rather than make things easier, and it's not even just easier, right? But there's even a limit to how easy those can possibly be. Because if the puzzle is really about distinguishing tones, if you have a hard time distinguishing tones, then it just, the puzzle can't be about what it's about anymore.
Right,
at some point, you have to make it into a different thing.
Yeah.
And that's not, like, the spirit of this game is that the puzzles are about things. Mm-hmm. So, people have complained to me sometimes, like, why don't you, put in captions what the sounds are? And it's like, because then the answer is just in the caption.
You immediately know it's about sounds, right?
Yeah. Not even that it's about sounds, but you would have to say, like, sounds, high tweet, low tweet.
Yeah.
It's like that's not, that's just not what this game is.
Yeah.
And so, but you do have to respect the fact, you have to respect everybody and respect the fact that some people are going to find that very difficult.
Right. I wanted to pull up the trophies here. Like, sure enough, Jungle is After Town is the second least completed area on the PS4.
Yeah, well, it's also hard to find, right?
Yeah, there's that, I guess.
But in that's interesting. I can't quite see. I'm squinting. So that and tree houses are within a couple percent.
Yeah.
Yeah. So
I found Marsh was by far the hardest for me, but
well, it's got a lot of puzzles, and some of them are really hard.
Yep.
But it's just to say that there's different ways of respecting the spectrum of people who are going to come to the game, right? And I don't think that they should all be. Make everything easy or take things out until everybody can play everything, because that really limits what your game can be. It limits where your game can reach and what it's allowed to do. And I didn't want to do that.
Yeah, I mean,
some people on the internet get very mad about that, and I take heat for it, but it was necessary.
Yeah, I mean, so I'm colorblind.
That's kind of why I came here.
So
I was actually surprised by there's different kinds of colorblindness and different. Some colorblind people. Have had no problem with this area.
And with me, it was, this specific area, this floor was not a problem. It was the stuff upstairs. There was like the second to last puzzle was tricky.
I'm not colorblind. I also
just shifted into a part of the spectrum where
basically,
you have problems.
Yeah. And it's something that I've been kind of trying to figure out better ways to put into words over the years, and just like what it is about color that I have, I have trouble
and
with.
And here we have a similar problem, right? Mm-hmm. So in video games, there's a bunch of best practices of what you do to make your game playable.
Right.
And it's usually, you know, have the different shapes. Like if you're making a match three, it's like different fruits or something, right?
But here you've got everything has to mean something. So if you change
and the colors,
pattern,
it has to be the same shape changing in color.
Right.
That's the point of the puzzle. And so we just couldn't do those things. And so, if you get stuck on that and it's because you legitimately physically can't do it, it's like, well, you look it up or something. That's cool.
And that's what I ended up doing. But actually, it wasn't even this way. I got through here. I think actually I had...
Oh, was it the ones in the center,
town
center?
In
okay,
town.
Interesting.
Those are the ones that were... And there's a logic to that I think I actually probably could have figured out. So the actual barrier with color blindness, or in my experience anyway, there's like the physical limitations where it's like, you know, I don't see red super well. So like the division is coming out, and when a grenade gets thrown, there's a pulsating red aura around you. I can barely see it.
Okay.
I can see it if I'm really paying attention.
Yeah.
But generally speaking, I don't really notice it. So there's like, there's the psychological aspect of like, because I don't see color well, I try to ignore it whenever possible.
Yeah.
So it actually became a situation where I kind of had to really just focus.
Because you've taught yourself.
Yes, exactly. And you kind of like turn that back on and go like, there's some things that I know I don't know, but like the logic in the color puzzles in town, actually, I probably could have figured out, but the real barrier was actually that was not the game itself.
Those ones actually are... It's really not so much a color puzzle anymore, but a logic puzzle. Because you have like red, green, and blue. If you can tell that the lights are three separate colors, which I think most people even can do. If you have red, green difficulties, for example, are you red, green, or are you...
I
forget the names for all
them. Protonopia. Deuteronopia, I don't see red super well.
Yeah.
And so like green and brown can look the same.
But what I've been told is that extreme tones are often easier to differentiate.
Yeah,
so like extreme red and extreme green. So if you know that it's three different colors, that particular puzzle doesn't have any intermediate colors,
right?
It's all essentially white or black under each lamp, and you can just figure it out as a logic puzzle on paper.
Yeah.
However, in your case, you don't necessarily know that that's true,
right? I can't trust that.
Yes.
So it becomes
much harder because there's information you don't have, basically.
Right. Yeah. So, for that situation, when I was here, my wife was with me, and she was able to just go like, okay, no, that one is different than that one. Like, oh, okay. And then I could just solve it immediately once I knew that. But it was cases like that.
During development, I tried several times over the course of 3 or 4 years to make an environmental puzzle that only colorblind people could see.
I saw how you mentioned that.
And we just couldn't do it. I mean,
there's so many different types of colorblind. Even within the three types,
And then it depends on how people's monitors are tuned and stuff, right?
Sure.
Because like, if certain tones are confused for you and a lot of people with similar category to yours, your monitors are gonna have different gammas and whatever, and they're just gonna come out different. So we couldn't do it, basically. If there's a way to do it, maybe
it's
in The Witness
too. It's a cool
idea.
Right?
But it's, people on the internet rant at me like, don't you care about colorblind people at all? And it's like, no, I tried to do cool stuff and just the game,
I can kind of be sympathetic to both sides because obviously, if you're dealing with it, it's frustrating. But at the same time, like, things like color and sound are such fundamental sensory aspects that, be able to work with those is like,
and
that has
I
to be
looked at it as like, it seems like, well, I guess like that's a, that's something I'd like to know about is like, did you kind of sit down and go like, okay, how many different ways can I carve up this type of line puzzle or how many different styles? Was that like an early process of like, okay, well, what if we did the one that was color-based? What if we did one that was sound-based? What if we,
Yeah, absolutely. So, like I said, there's the basic idea of the game, which is, hey, you're drawing these lines,
right?
And then beyond that, so I knew that eventually it was going to segue into environmental puzzles. But before that, there has to be some system for how do you draw lines, right? So I came up with a little panel thing, and okay, there's going to be some logic puzzles early on. And then let's explore a few different types of that. So before you even get to the physical phenomena, there's some basic ideas, like, okay, separating the colors, or you got to go over all the little dots, right?
Yeah.
Or there could be symmetry, like all that stuff. But then it's exactly as you say, like, okay, that's not the only way of getting information of how to solve a puzzle. So what are the other ways mm-hmm. that, and you know, thematically, the game is about understanding the world, right?
Right.
To say very broadly.
Yeah.
So then the different puzzle types in the game are sort of meditations on different things that could happen in the physical world. Mm-hmm. Like, hey, you know, color can combine with other color in a certain way.
Yeah.
Or, you know, glare off of a surface mm-hmm. behaves in a certain way depending on its angle. And some of these are more subtle, right? So people will go to that glare area,
yeah.
right? And they'll get the basic idea, but they won't get it well enough. Like, I get complaints from some percentage of players like, yeah. oh, that area was just very tedious because it was just like about walking all over the place to find the right spot. And it's like, actually, no. If you look at the angle and you understand what's going on, you can walk directly to the right spot
right.
every time. So there yeah. is a skill element, but I wanted to cover that phenomenon and not make it so brutally hard. You, mm-hmm. There's trade-offs everywhere. So it was like, okay,
right.
you can kind of brute force those in the sense
yeah.
that you walk everywhere until you see it, but there is a player skill dimension, right?
that ended up being the area that I took the most, like, phone pictures and, like, you know, okay, let's get this to Photoshop and flip it and do, you know, just to kind of, you know, it was partially, there was a lot on paper, but then
yeah.
at some point with those puzzles specifically, yeah. I just kind of like, okay, I'm going to.
Do you know that you can trace puzzles from far away?
Yes.
Okay.
I use that.
Because if you don't know that in that area, it
one of my favorite
harder.
Moments, yeah. and I don't know if it was intentional yeah. or not, but was in the tree houses where I could not solve the last puzzle I needed to complete a bridge.
To get to the.
But there
the
was
a thing, the drawbridge?
Well, it's in the tree. It's yeah. It was one of the earlier bridges, but there was okay. another bridge above it, which was like, you know, in real life would have been like 20 feet away.
Yeah.
I could barely make out the puzzle well enough to interact with it, much less solve it, but
yeah.
I managed to solve it and extended a bridge above me one square while I was still on a bridge.
Which wasn't helpful.
That I hadn't, and it didn't do anything for me, but I like wanted to jump out of my seat. I was so excited.
Yeah.
Real quick, just because I've been hanging out in this room
yeah.
for so long, because I have a completely different bone to pick with this
right.
puzzle than Jeff did.
All right.
Since you were talking about like kind of ways of knowing and interpreting information and stuff like that,
yeah.
I got stuck on this puzzle for days because I was an idiot and didn't stop and think, wait, this whole area is about color. That's what I need to be thinking about here.
Okay.
I got completely misdirected, and I want to know if this is intentional, because I noticed that this 4x5 grid
yeah, you know
is
what?
The same as this pattern on the floor. If you kind of, you know, assume that these are two squares cross. And I was just wondering, and also, like, I even got to the point where I was like, well, this pipe sort of looks like the shape of a
yeah.
solution. Like, maybe that's what he's getting at. Like,
believe it or not,
did you intend
actually,
any of that misdirection, or is that just a coincidence that
this area
is,
used to be more of a red herring, because these little hanging pepper plant things were actually kind of aligned with the grid.
That's exactly what I thought it was. I was
yeah,
like, these have to correspond to the color blocks.
This
like,
is
what
a
is
thing
going
where maybe we needed to deal with this more.
Mm.
But it's not totally obvious how to deal with it, because, you know, there's architects involved designing the buildings, and we have to control the amount of light getting to mm-hmm. the thing. And, mm-hmm. like, so maybe we should have taken these grid lines out, but by the time we realized it was a thing, it was maybe a little late.
Mm-hmm.
But maybe if, like, the grids in one direction weren't there, and they were just in the other direction.
Yeah.
That would have been an.
Okay.
I don't know.
I just needed to know if this was an intentional fuck you or not.
No, it was. I didn't want it. And in fact, that's actually one of the harder game design skills mm-hmm. of a puzzle game, is knowing in advance what people are going to get confused by. Because
sure.
people don't.
Yeah.
You design a puzzle and you know what it's about and you mm-hmm. know what the answer is. A player coming in fresh
mm-hmm.
doesn't very often know what it's about. Sometimes they'll figure it out quickly, but sometimes they won't. And that's the hard part. The hardest part of a puzzle game is when you're at that point where you're like, I have no idea what I'm supposed to do or where the answer is or whatever. And that is the part in a puzzle game where people start trying random things. And that's where you want to make it the most possible for people to get traction and for them to be the least misled, unless your game is about red herrings or something.
Sure.
But this one wasn't, right? And so the environments in this game usually are very, very minimal, actually, right? Like, especially in the starting area, like you're in this hallway and mm-hmm. you come out to kind of a barren yard. There's like not that much stuff, whereas most games would put stuff.
Right.
And we kept scaling that back because we wanted two things. We wanted people to understand that the interactivity was very simple, mm-hmm. and we also didn't want to have a lot of red herrings all over the place. Now, this one has more stuff because, I mean, on one hand it does, on the other hand it doesn't. Like, it's got a lot of plants and stuff. Because we felt like there needed to be a fictional justification for having all these rooms with different colors, otherwise it's a little artificial. But there's not, like, racks full of test tubes and beakers and, you know, faucets or whatever, like you would have if you were building out a facility like this, because we didn't want people to think, like, oh, should I be trying to turn all these faucets? So I did my best, and apparently I didn't do well enough on that one.
Chalk it up to user error.
We'll get more notes for the witness, too.
Yeah, exactly. But no, it's one of those things where, you know, about, it was certainly in the last year of development, a couple people were like, oh, this is a weird red herring. And I'm like, oh, I didn't realize.
Oh, sure.
But yeah, that grid is the same as the puzzle. And then we addressed it, but like not enough. And the thing is, in a game that's this big, there's 600 and something puzzles, right? And they're all different. And just every single puzzle is an opportunity to have one of those red herrings. And I tried, man. I really tried.
Go ahead.
It seems like a lot of people had opportunities to play different versions of The Witness over the years.
And
how crucial was that into just like getting a fresh set of eyes to just like come in and stare at it for a while?
It's important, but I always like to say in interviews that I don't like do play testing the way that larger games do, because I don't really believe in that. Like, I don't believe in the survey of like play testing to decide what should be in the game, or even to decide what things need the most work or something. I mean, sometimes, right? But for me, it's a more basic reality check. Like, are people confused in places I don't want them to be confused, right? Are they finding red herrings, or like, do things even work, or do they crash if you, like, sometimes, like, even if you've got in-house testers, you guys are all running through the game the same way, and somebody comes at it from a total different direction, right?
It sounds like kind of a minor but important distinction in terms of philosophy of playtesting. It seems like a lot of developers playtest with the intention of, like, well, I'm going to make this more fun based on what people, like, I'm going to make
internal fight we're having by having a bunch of other people come in, or
more to the point, like, I'm going to make this more what the person who's playing it wants it to be, as opposed to I'm going to test what I want it to be against how they're experiencing.
But there's the thing that I find about player feedback is, so it's important to get some, I think, otherwise you're completely detached from reality and that's bad, right? It's important to look at what people say, but there's usually two parts to feedback. There's like, you know, okay, there's positive and negative. Let's talk about negative, because that's the ones that people usually react to. Positive is like, okay, cool, I wanted that to be good, it was good, whatever. Negative feedback is usually of the form, I didn't like this, or I didn't understand this, or this was hard, because whatever, right? And the most useful part is the I didn't like this, or this was hard, right? And maybe that's fine, because again, I'm not trying to please everybody with 100% of the game.
And some parts are supposed to be hard.
Yeah, some parts
are
supposed to be hard.
You know, if you're sitting someone down for 45 minutes, like, there were things that I needed a night's sleep.
Exactly.
To come back, and then like you wake up, boot up the game, finish that puzzle in 30 seconds, go, oh, damn it.
But you do have to take that a little bit to heart, and a little bit. But so the important part is just the information that something isn't working well. Mm-hmm. It's not the because. Because because that people will say, or instead of because of something, they'll say, I wish this was more like something else or more in a certain way. And those suggestions of how to fix something usually, it's not that they're not good ideas, but it's just that the way, especially in a game that's subtle like this, the way a puzzle comes off and how easy or hard it is, depends on everything else in the game. It depends on the whole play experience. So like, people think this game is kind of hard. Some people think it's a hard game now, but it was the same puzzles, was brutally hard before it was a beautiful game.
Sure.
Because you were playing these puzzles, and I mean, in my opinion, it's beautiful. I'm not saying everyone should think it's beautiful, right?
Well, I think you're getting at that there was not as much sensory information available, right? In terms of visuals and sounds.
And as you walk from one area to another, it gives something for part of your mind to do. Mm-hmm. Part of it just being aesthetic appreciation, but part of it just being the exploration instinct, right? When it's just like a bunch of blobby hills, like a height map with like some puzzles on it, there's not like that exploration part of your brain doesn't kick in. And so you don't shift between modes of what you're doing, mm-hmm. and so the puzzle-solving part of your brain doesn't really get a rest, right?
Yeah.
Whereas here, if you just did that stuff, and then you walked out here to the shipwreck and looked around, this is like a rest that you get.
Right.
And then you come back in, and you're a little bit recharged in a way that you wouldn't be. Mm-hmm. And that's really subtle.
And
yeah. just changing the color of some areas or something, or just putting a little more visual work into something, determines how hard the puzzles are near that area. Like, that
right.
is so...
Yeah.
And so, you know, what I take from playtests is like, okay, maybe there's something wrong, or maybe we haven't done a good enough job somewhere yet. But that doesn't mean... I mean, you know, yet, but the yet is important too, because we're early in development, and we're expecting to do a lot more work, right?
Right.
And like, is it naturally going to get better?
Yeah.
So. You need to stay connected to reality, but you have to not knee-jerk react to all that stuff. And I think a lot of people do, right?
So that actually kind of brings me to something I was curious about. We had, was it mid-2011? If you remember, Ryan Davis and Patrick Klepek came for us to
yeah.
your apartment.
They came to my
five
apartment
years
and
ago
played on the couch.
And played
yeah.
like 3 hours of this game. I was curious, like, I think they came away from it with you having told them basically like all, the puzzles are all in the game at this point. So I was
yeah,
kind of curious, like,
that turns out not to have been
true. So
accurate.
Is that not true? So I was wondering, like was it were you still working by yourself at that point, or had you already
no.
started hiring people? Like, I was curious, like, when the team started coming together.
We
and,
had a
and,
we
like,
had a small team at that time. So
yeah.
there was me and like a couple other people working full time, mm-hmm. and then, you know, maybe some audio contractors and stuff, but they hadn't even totally geared up yet. But
yeah.
what it was that was my okay, the mission statement of the game is all together and you can play it. It looked pretty ugly, like...
They even brought
some
screenshots
back. It was like
slab yeah.
buildings. It was total programmer art.
Yes.
But it was like playable and you could play a bunch of interesting stuff.
Like the concepts were there.
The concepts were there. There were environmental puzzles, but there weren't that many. There were like 10 or 11. Mm. But you could have found them at that time. I had thought that at that point, okay, we're just going to gear up and finish the game.
Yeah.
And we just kept adding more stuff while gearing up and finishing the game, right?
Right.
So
So how late in development were new puzzles still being added into the game, would you say?
I added a couple, like, in January.
Oh, wow.
Or late December. Most of those were, like, replacing older puzzles
okay.
that I didn't like.
Yeah. Were there any just...
It wasn't like building new areas.
Okay, sure, right. Were there any major categories of you know, we talk about like there are the color puzzles, there's sound puzzles, there are a lot of like
yeah.
abstract logic puzzles, but were there any yeah. major categories that you didn't think of until you started seeing the bigger game take shape?
So the whole area, the last major thing was that area, the ruins in the middle of town where mm-hmm. you were kind of hanging out earlier.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Which was empty until about a year ago.
Okay.
And the idea was going to be, oh, there's going to be cool environment puzzles in here, and you're just going to pass through it a lot going from place to place, and it's going to be really reinforce that idea that I've seen these things
oh,
all
sure.
over.
Yeah.
Like, I thought this was a barren area, mm-hmm. and yet I come back and there's a bunch of stuff in it. That idea, when I started trying to execute it, didn't work out that well because the puzzle started to seem really forced. It was going to be about bringing together all the areas in the island. So you'd be in a ruin, and like the wall would have a certain kind of hole in it, and then the windmill would sort of fit into that shape and fill out the environment
yeah.
puzzle or whatever. And we were going to do that with five or six different things. So it was going to be mm-hmm. thematic and cool, but in reality, those were hard enough to do that they kind of sucked to play, and they were mm-hmm. ugly and whatever.
Yeah.
Like, so it was too forced. So I was like, well, let me take that theme to the panels. There's still a bunch of environment stuff here, but it's
right.
not the only thing now.
Yeah.
It's like, okay,
just kind of
let's
take
bring that theme to
panels from all the other areas,
and
bring
them together.
Yeah.
You know, and prior to this, there are areas in the game where ideas come together, but they're usually, okay, I'm going to bring the theme, like in the tree houses, it brings in some ideas from other areas.
Right.
But they're all to play with the treehouse theme, right? And this is the area where everything can sort of do anything with everything, and
yeah.
it's all packed together. And I think that comes across, and it's cool to play.
It was nice because, you know, you are kind of moving through that area a lot, and yeah. it's just the sort of thing where as you're kind of getting more information, it was like every yeah. time you move through town, you're like, oh, I totally know how to do yeah. this now.
Now, right. now, the downside of the way that we did this area is it can be intimidating to new players, especially mm-hmm. if you decide not to play all the stuff on the easy
sure.
side of the island,
yeah.
right? Because the geography over there kind of encourages you to stay on that side, but there's several points at which you can break across and just run through. And if you run through, that's one of the main places you may end up first.
Right.
With a bunch of puzzles you can't do yet. And some people are fine with that. They're like, oh, this looks really hard. Let me keep exploring. But some people get really annoyed and frustrated
by that.
They
just stand there and stare at it. Yeah. What do I need to do?
Now, we try to prime them on that by having that vault early on mm-hmm. that you're likely mm-hmm. to see yep. that has a really hard
right.
puzzle on it.
Yeah.
Yet, some people get annoyed, right? And so, but I was, again, fine with that because I'm not really about making the most fun game all the time. I'm about making the most interesting game, and especially interesting once you're in the mid to late game and you can put it all together in your head, right? And sometimes that's just how it comes out, is it's a little less tutorializing, right?
Sure,
or whatever.
Right. Yeah, it's interesting to hear you refer to the easy side of the island, because I mean, like, it's obvious that Cemetery is where the game funnels you to first.
Yeah.
It's pretty straightforward to get through, but
the Desert Ruin is not necessarily like.
I thought it was on the easier side by the game standards.
If you get the idea,
yeah.
See, I
right?
walked
if
over here and looked at it just, and didn't immediately see what it was.
Yeah.
Didn't immediately catch on to what I was supposed to be doing. And went like, oh well, maybe I need something else. I'll come back.
Right.
And then
yeah.
I ran off and basically played through the entire quarry. Like, that was the
which
second
is crazy,
second
which is supposed to be
on.
Hard. Actually,
yeah. And,
quarry
and
was
so
by
like,
far
that was one of the things
ones.
Looking at the percentages on PS4 of completion yeah. and seeing like, oh, apparently that's a hard area. Like, quarry was not. There was the one piece of information I needed from another area. But about, at that point, I was kind of going around.
There's
and
sort of two,
stuff.
Though. I mean, did you go down the stone steps? Because there's like a pretty hard, what people call it, Tetris piece puzzles, but I don't call them that.
Yeah.
Fear of litigation.
Sure, yeah.
The shape, square pieces, puzzles.
I think I ended up just... So I didn't find the marsh for a while. So
or
I
did
think,
you get in from the shadow?
I got into the quarry from the shadowy world.
Or you could get in from the...
Yeah, I did. It was from the shadows. I did all the shadow stuff and ended up in that one.
That's how I went there, too.
And started on that area and over in, I guess, kind of where the boat is, hit those puzzles where I'm like, mm-hmm. oh, I don't even know
that's
what any of this means.
That's similar to what I did.
But then went off and found that stuff and then came back and that ended up, like I said, being the second laser I turned on.
Wow, okay. That's pretty good. She got through there.
Yeah. Well, it was one of those things, like, comparing notes with him, because this was still prior to release, and there weren't a lot of people to talk about, and he was just like, what? Like, looking at his trophies versus my trophies and all that stuff.
Or he was like the third last place I did, I think, or something like that.
But again, if you're ready to do that, right, then, or if you're finding that a good enough experience as a player, then why not let people do that,
totally.
Right? So this game is structured to allow it.
So, yeah, I was kind of going to ask if you, like, it sounds like you don't have any preferred way or prescribed way to go through the game. Like, I was going to say that the desert, for whatever reason, ended up being the very last area that I interacted with at all. Like, I had touched every other area, even the town, before I came here and tried to do anything. And I don't know why that is, but...
In my mind, this is likely to be an early area. Mm-hmm. But again, people hit it sometimes and bounce because they don't see it. And in that case, it could be arbitrarily late because it's like way over there. And you're not really going to pass it very much, right?
Yeah, and I ended up, for me, it was a situation where, you know, like I just didn't come back for a long time, and I was doing other stuff, and then finally I kind of hit some walls elsewhere, and I was like, well, I'm going to wander around some more and just see what I find. I came back, like, oh man, I haven't even done anything here, and then once I spent another 15 minutes there, so I went, oh, okay, and then immediately got in.
Yeah. For me, for some reason, a desert feels like a late-game video game environment. I have no idea why I have that bias, but I was just like, I should come back here at the end of the game.
It's not a water temple.
Yeah, exactly. Is there anything going on with this thing? Have people figured that out?
Is that I'm not at liberty to say.
Is that always there? I can't remember. I haven't gone back and started a new file to see if those are always there or not. You're not gonna. Okay,
so I'm not gonna say anything.
Are there things in the? I mean, I know people have finished. What is it? 523 is the base number, and then there's the 100 and something.
I actually.
Is there anything else in the game to find?
I honestly, people ask me that question, and I resist going and looking up exactly how many puzzles there are, so I don't know.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
You know, but my position on that is just, you know, we don't just. There's several levels of things in the game, right? There's the panel puzzles, there's the environmental puzzles, both of which are tracked, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then there's things to notice or understand that are just, did you notice this thing, right?
Okay.
And
okay.
those are sort of the next level of subtlety down, and we put a bunch of those in the game.
Yeah.
And,
there's one
really, whenever we had an opportunity to do so.
Like Like, for instance, this has been dogging me for weeks, and I don't know if there's anything to be gleaned from it, or if it's, like you said, it's just there to...
It, you know...
Like, so, for, you know, those flowers appear everywhere. It's like a recurring motif, for one thing, is this white flower, but then also there's this, which I didn't even notice the first time, but...
Yeah. What I think is, you know, I like to take some cues from, you know, more interesting films or novels or something where... You can come back later and get more out of it, right? And in video games, I mean, you could kind of do that with video games, but not really for several reasons,
right? Not many of them.
And one reason is still in the video game medium, we've got this thing where games are kind of perishable. They're kind of a product of their time and the technology level and stuff. And I think we're a little less perishable than we used to be. Like, games from the early 2000s are like unplayable at this point by anyone except a serious, serious game person.
Right. Yeah.
But I think we're still kind of perishable, but I'm still doing my best to like make something that you can appreciate a different dimension of 10 years later, right, for example, or even 1 year later, right? How many games can you play again a year later and not have it just be sort of a repeat of the same experience,
like, hey, I'm gonna revisit this thing.
Really get more.
Yeah.
It's hard. It's a hard design problem, but part of the reason it's hard is because we don't practice it that much as game designers too.
Sure.
So it was like, okay, let me... you know, there's a part of the game where you could feel reasonably satisfied where you've 100%ed it or whatever, but then there is a part of the game that is just more open, and it's not about giving you that satisfaction. It's about being open, right? And so that's just how it is. If some people want that, like, some people just like want that cocaine hit of like,
right,
like, fuck, I, yeah,
I 100% beat this thing. What? Fuck yeah, yeah.
Is that okay to say that on here?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Just want to fire my dopamine. Just give it to me.
Yeah.
You know, and that is a thing that video games do very well, right? Mm-hmm. And that's cool. I don't want to bash. That's a cool thing. But I also, there's not very much of the other thing of the. Mm-hmm. Oh my God, I don't even know how far this goes. That's not a thing that we do these days.
That was definitely the sense I had upon. Like finishing the game, you know, with not all the lasers lit and kind of getting in the elevator and doing my thing, was that feeling of like, well, I'm clearly not done. You know, there was this definite feeling of just like, I'm going to go back and do more of this. And then it wasn't too long after that I got the rest of the lasers going. And
But again, that's intended to be a choice too. It's like, okay, cool.
Absolutely.
if you want to be done, if you feel like, okay, I've had my fill of this stuff, then you could choose that as a stopping point. You're like, all right. Mm-hmm. But if you not, right, then there's plenty more.
Jeff, did you find this naturally?
Yes.
I did too. It's, and it was like you talk about.
Awesome.
Yeah.
This was because I, you know, getting through this area, I had seen that there's a cable here that is not lit up.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, and where does it go? And getting up there and actually seeing that.
And even just the way that the thing that you trace to get in stops at the very edge of the panel is a little bit funny, but you maybe don't notice. But
we absolutely did not notice it. The days, like, there was a Saturday morning after I had like finished the game with the seven lasers, where I knew there was more. I knew it was related to the mountain somehow. And my girlfriend and I sat there for like an hour running around in this goddamn mountain. Tracing that cable up and
down.
But
see, that's the thing. It's like, you see this cable right here, and you see it lead to that tower and go, well, there's something here.
Right.
So I just, for me, it was just like,
but it was basically when we threw up our hands saying, all right, we'll come back to this later, and I was walking out of here and just happened to have the camera angled like that and just like fell out of my chair.
But at least you saw it.
Oh, it was so great.
Yeah.
No, it was great.
It's very easy to be looking directly at it and then not even notice.
Like from above, you're right, it's not evident, but from, like, I just happened to swing the camera around and it was this huge aha moment.
So you talk about, you know, the game kind of coming from a lot of the environmental puzzles and those kind of concepts, but what about, like, I guess, like, the lore side of it, or, you know, like putting in audio logs and kind of, you know, like one of the things that, you know, as I kind of continue playing the game, there's a part of me that almost really wants that hit of like here's the info dump of here's what's really going on.
Yeah, and you know, the original concept of the game like had that in it. And
when you start to see stuff like this at the end of the game, you start thinking, okay, there is a hidden truth to this. There's some coherent mechanism taking place underneath this island. What's going on?
Yeah, originally it was going to be very much like the radio play like you have in a lot of first-person shooters or whatever, but it was going to be interesting because it was had to be more nonlinear. Because mm-hmm. I didn't want to cheat. I could just cheat and like everyone you find plays the next one, but that's lame, right? Yeah. They got to be like themed to go with the different areas and whatever. Mm-hmm. So that was going to be an interesting design challenge. But then, and I was super excited about that in 2008, 2009.
Sure.
But one thing about a long development is, you know, this game took 6.5 or 7 years for people who don't know that.
Yeah.
It's a long time to design. You change a lot as a person in 6 or 7 years and what you're excited about. Mm-hmm. And also the idea itself matures a lot, right? And
yeah.
So toward the end, I had gone through many revisions of what the story was going to be. And I just didn't like it. Because the game itself is about understanding the world clearly. Like, it's about having clarity and and having these moments of surprise or epiphany that help you understand the world more clearly. And so going in a very... Also adding, there's actually two problems. Like one is also adding this heavy fiction felt like really there, it fought with that idea.
Sure.
But then also just adding a lot of talking sort of clashed with the nonverbal communication that the game's about mm-hmm. a lot of times. But I did want to have something, right? So
right.
I just kept messing with it. And eventually it's like, okay, there is going to be talking. It's going to be in the form of like these readings, which were originally going to be used to parallel. They're going to be like two or three sets of audio logs. And the readings were like one of them, and the story stuff was another one. And I eventually diminished the story stuff until it's like six things that are hidden and barely in the game,
yes.
right? That a lot of people
yes.
will never hear.
I've heard four of those.
Yeah, and that was the first one that I was actually happy with, and it's a good thing because it was 1 month before ship or whatever. like, we recorded those... on January 7, and the game shipped January 26.
Yeah.
And
if I interpreted the review notes correctly, those six audio logs
were not in there.
They were not in the review build when I got access to it.
Yeah.
So
there was one of them was sort of halfway.
Okay.
But yeah.
Is there? So I've like I said, I think I found four of those, and I'm heading down to that area right now. But like, even having heard all of those and beaten the challenge and seen the video after that and everything, like, is there still? Is there a single ultimate truth that you would intend for people to take away from this, or is it still even at that point open to?
I'd prefer to let people notice what they're gonna. I don't feel like it's healthy to like mm-hmm. dictate what people should get out of the thing. But yeah, I mean, about the whole story thing, like this was again one of those decisions where it's like I have to be true to the game that I want to make, mm-hmm. and that's taking me in the opposite direction. It's like, if I want to make the most money, or I want to have the highest Metacritic or whatever,
sure.
you know that some people want that, mm-hmm. right? And so, if you want those people to be excited about your game and talking about your game, then you put a radio play in there, because it's proven to work, and you can do something that'll at least be, you know, mm-hmm. you can tell from the other production values in this game is not exactly AAA, but it's fine. It's like for an independent team, it satisfies, right? It's good.
Yeah.
So we could have done that with a radio play. It would have been good. I mean, we certainly had really good voice actors
on
the game.
You went and rounded up some
of the best of the best,
pretty,
right?
Good people, yeah.
So we could have done that, but it felt wrong. I would have felt like I'd betrayed myself a little bit.
Yeah.
So we didn't do it. But that does leave, like you're talking about, for people who want story, they want that, and we're not giving them that, and that's just what it is.
To illustrate the point, I'm very tempted to activate this elevator right now. I won't go there because people have presumably seen that, but...
Should we be talking about more specific things? I don't even know how much time we have.
We got all the time that you have.
I feel like
honestly,
you're just sort of walking around.
Yeah, I am, and I honestly I don't want this video to turn into a giant airing of grievances. But man, this mountain, holy shit! Like,
it's hard,
having
right?
to finish this on a deadline to get the review done was not fun. I mean, it was very engaging and it was very satisfying, but like it was grueling to get through some of this stuff.
That's another thing that's weird about reviews, right? Because it's a hard game, and even though we gave reviewers couple of weeks or something. Mm-hmm. It's a big game.
It is,
right? And a couple of weeks, if you're going to see everything, means you're spending a majority of the time, right? And so, and that's a different condition than people are going to play.
It is.
Home.
It's a weird thing for me because, like, honestly, like growing up, that is how I always played games, was devouring them. I was like, I'm going to sit down and just, like, I'm going to play this game for 14 hours straight and do this. And it ended up, you know, that ended up lending itself really well to me becoming a game reviewer.
Yeah. Yeah.
But now,
but also
nowadays,
you didn't have to devour them. It was like you wanted to,
right,
so you did.
And yeah, then, and it definitely there are situations where if you are on a deadline and the game is broken,
or
you're in a situation where, like, okay, you're like, you're just stuck and there's nowhere to turn. It is a different level of frustration.
That was the situation with this
game. So we do things, you know, it's been the nice thing about getting out of a lot of that rat race and treating games a little differently now is, you know, we review games when it makes sense to, and we can pick and choose a lot more than we used to.
In this case, this was a weird case of, like, I was just so impressed and enamored with the game that I wanted to get out there at the same time everybody else was, when people cared about reviews and, like,
I was just playing it to play it just as intensely as he was.
Yeah.
The review situation is always a bit of a weird one.
Some of this stuff was a real fucker to finish in one afternoon, though, I'm not gonna lie.
Well, this sequence in general is one of my favorite ones.
In retrospect, it was super cool. At the time, I was like, there is no fucking way I can fit two solutions on the same board and make this work. And then ultimately, I realized you have to go back and forth three or four times.
So this is a spoiler a little bit, but it keeps going after this, by the way. There's more to do with this.
I noticed that, you know, obviously these are shaped a certain way.
Yeah.
I got one of those below.
And so, you got one of them.
But I realized
if you
I would
want
have
to get the other one.
Yeah. I realized I would have to resolve this puzzle again to get the other one. I was just like, I can't right now.
Yeah, I think, you know, I started the game with the assumption that there would be a single solution to puzzles. And then you very quickly, like, oh, no, okay.
With some of them, there is because of the nature of it, like the shadow ones or something like that.
That one over there was another very profound one. Like, conceptually, like, an incredible idea for a puzzle.
Yeah.
In practice, like, very grueling at the time to get it done quickly.
This one, I think, ends up with a single solution. I
mean, really?
Not because it's programmed that way, but just because it's hard enough that there's really only one thing you can do.
Or there are just so many different conditions to satisfy. Have you seen, it's effectively a piece of Witness fan art that I've seen going around on Twitter, which is just it's probably like a 20x20
giant
grid
puzzle thing,
where every single space is filled with a symbol from the game. Like, have you looked at that thing? Do you think
I glanced at it.
Is it solvable?
That's what I want to know, if it's actually solvable.
It could be a giant troll.
Yeah.
So, that's because you've spent so many years with this.
Yeah.
If you're presented with one of these puzzles, not one of the ones that you created, but if someone were to say, like, hey, here's 100 puzzles in this style, would you just be able to just break through them immediately?
Probably better than most people, right? But I still, you know, once in a while I'm playing the speed run and I'm looking at one and I'm like, damn it, you know, this is hard.
I mean, you saw what he did before we started recording with one of the ones I hadn't finished yet. You just kind of sat down and blew through it in like 20 seconds.
Yeah, I mean, in the last year of development, I played the game a lot, like you have to. If you're responsible for the experience of what it is to play this game,
right,
and it's such a subtle game like this where, like, the color of something determines how hard the puzzle is because it determines how much you notice that detail or whatever.
Sure.
You have to be responsible for the experience. Someone has to be, or it's not going to be very good, first of all, right? And then, you know, you just have to play it and play it and play it. So in addition to, like, programming and designing puzzles and stuff, I, like, just played things a lot. And some of that was in the form of doing the whole game beginning to end, but some of it was just replaying areas and stuff. So I don't know how many times I've played the game cumulatively, but it's a lot. Probably there is nobody in the world still who has played it as many times as me. Although possibly that's not true anymore. You never know.
I imagine it must be getting there. Game is out longer.
It always gets there, right?
I forget, one of the blogs ran a story yesterday about somebody setting a new speedrun record, at least in the speedrunning community. I don't know what your personal record is.
For the whole game?
I didn't read the entire story. I'm not sure what the specifics were.
Yeah, I mean, I saw people even like a week after the game came out. There were some people on Twitch who had pretty good times for getting to the elevator or whatever.
Yeah. This is going to be a weird one with speedrunners, though, because at a point people will just memorize the solutions as opposed to intuiting them on the spot.
Yeah, well, you know? and that's just the kind of game that this
sure,
is.
Sure. Which brings us to the challenge, I feel like. Because, like, the challenge, I feel like, is a pretty impressive way to cap off a game that revolves around static puzzle solutions for the most part. With a thing that cannot be brute forced or memorized.
Right, and that was part of what I was... So there's a few dimensions to that. One was like, hey, let's make an action challenge in this game that is ostensibly a quiet thinking game. It's another dimension to go to. And like we were talking about, going to all these places of like different phenomena. It's not exactly a phenomenon, but it's like... bringing time into it, and like how well have you absorbed all these things?
Right. Yeah.
And if you haven't absorbed them well enough to do it, then it's a way to hone and practice that, right? Mm-hmm. Some people really don't like that because it's hard.
it's like a boss rush or something. Yeah, you know,
In fact, it got harder in the last month of development.
Really?
Because I had to pick the real music for it, and ended up being 30 seconds shorter.
I was gonna ask if you started with a time limit in mind.
I also made the puzzles harder.
Man.
But
I guess I don't feel quite so bad.
Yeah.
I do intend to sit down and commit myself to finishing this thing at some point.
I got to it, and then was interrupted, and had to play a couple of other games, and I was out for a little while. And now I'm worried that like the amount of I'm going to have to ramp back up on everything, just rehone it.
Yeah, that's
how
I feel.
Zone or whatever.
I mean, part of that is, you know, we're just constantly bouncing from game to game so rapidly, but yeah, dude. I don't think I can.
So do we want to see if I can do it?
Let's see if you can do it.
Because I might fail. It's quite likely.
I certainly cannot sit in front of you and try this thing myself.
Let me give it a try.
Jason,
also caveat that I don't usually play on the gamepad.
Okay.
Right.
Do you need music, or I guess
let's do the music.
Really, yeah, Jason, can we get some music?
The music is bad for your nerves, so I should have it.
It is, but it also, I don't know, there's an urgency to it, I feel like.
Yeah. All right, so what happens? I could well just get stuck on the third panel.
Right.
Not the third panel.
And also, like I said, don't forget that you will effectively be earning me the platinum here.
I'll stop before we... All right. So am I going? Yeah. What am I waiting for? All right. Oh, gamepad. Let's see. Oh, this is a tricky one. Sorry.
Once in a while, this one. Oh, there you go.
Yeah. Oh, that's easy. All right. Oh, I'm so clumsy with the gamepad. Okay, so the secret here is that this is a map to the thing.
But I find
so I've got to go left, right, and then hook.
But I find it so hard
I've got to go left, right, two, and then hook the other way.
I find
way.
It so hard to integrate that information.
Sometimes
you're
it's easier to
so
remember.
Fast.
So I'm going to go whoosh, whoosh, and I got an S. I don't know. I don't know if I'm going
to
remember.
It's not like you have time to stop and write it down, you know?
All right, so panel. There. All right, so. So I always try to see as many panels as I can at once, right? It's a basic thing. All right, so this looks kind of straightforward.
Okay.
All right. Okay. That's there, and then it's got to hook up to.
Nope.
No, it is. It's just I went the wrong way.
Oh, yeah.
So, wait. There.
Yes.
Yeah. Oh. And then I go around. Ugh, slip. I need to practice more on the gamepad. All right. So, is that... I should memorize which ones I did so I don't flail like this. All right. And this is sort of a breather, usually.
Yeah.
Like, I usually don't even look at the full... Wow. If you don't hit the B button, that's if I fail the speed run, that's why right there. All right, so the next ones, there's two rows of these, and one is, that one's unsolvable, as you can tell from the upper left.
Yep. It took me a little bit to realize
this
that
one
was,
is solvable. Yeah, so only one is solvable in each of these.
Yep.
And so if you get stuck, it's a good perception exercise to work on about knowing, okay, that doesn't look that solvable to me.
Hmm.
That looks maybe. This looks.
Yeah, that maybe.
Yeah, I think this one.
Probably.
Yep. Yeah. So you know, you get an instinct for. Okay, so I go left, right two, and I hook like an S. Okay, here's the first one of these. These got added late in development, so. Oh, slip. Oh, okay.
Oh, no.
I shouldn't have done that. That may have lost me the run there.
Yeah, I've had that experience.
I was cocky.
For sure.
Oh, wait.
You're still making way better time than I have, but.
All right. Oh, come on.
but I've had that exact experience.
So the plus side, if that one was really hard, I mean, I might have actually made time there anyway because it gives me an easier one.
Oh, it'll right? generate a different puzzle?
Yeah.
Okay.
So 2, 2, 2, 1, 1, 2.
Nope, you got.
Oh, God, I did it again.
Yep.
Okay, this is.
I've done the exact same
thing. Oh, my God.
Yeah.
Okay,
so many
where
times.
Am I? Where am I? Now I don't even know which way I'm facing.
That's the other one.
God, okay. Now I'm choking. This is just.
Yeah. Playing games and talking, turns out.
Yeah.
Not the easiest thing.
Okay, this time I'm going to double check my answer before I put. Oh, God, are we on Hall of the Mountain King already? If we are, I'm doomed. Okay, so this is probably. No, it's got to be the other way because of the one.
One,
I'm so doomed.
Two.
So 1, 2, 1, 1, right? 1, 1, 1, 2, 3. All right. So.
Oh, wow. That's a good roll.
1, 2, 1, 2, 2, 2. Okay. So I hooked like an S, and then I'm going to bumble my way through the maze. Okay, so we've got lateral symmetry going out. This doesn't. What do I have to hit on this side? Up there. I've got to hit that. So I'm going to go this. There. Oh, no. Oh, God. All right. Sometimes they're hard, man.
Yeah.
Oop. Okay, so I'm going to go here.
Yep.
Here. What? What else did I miss? Oh, no. It's that one. All right, I think I can hit that pretty straightforwardly. I think it was that one? Let me just do this just to be safe. Because for all I know, I didn't look at. Oh, come on.
But there's still that one, right?
Where is it? It's in my head, it's in a different spot.
Yeah.
It's there, okay, it's below that dot. Oh, God.
Oh, wow.
Okay. It's. Okay, come on,
come on.
Oh, this one's easy. Oh, no, it's not.
Oh, boy.
No, it is easy, though. Okay, I believe that's the solution. Right? Because, those are the only white spots in there. But I'm not going to give you the platinum.
Yeah, okay.
All right?
I didn't want you to be honest, but.
Those are the only three whites, so they just had to be sandwiched.
Yeah.
So I made it with a good 12 seconds of spare, despite screwing up like five times.
Yeah, that's not bad at all.
So do these puzzles pull from a pool of existing puzzles, or is it actually generated?
They're randomly generated. And in fact, there's a couple frame hitches during some spots, especially as you go to those sets of three, because it's generating like three puzzles at once. Mm-hmm. And it has to generate some that are unsolvable, which is like the hardest case.
Oh,
so unfortunately, you know, on PCs, you don't really feel it because the processor is different. But on the PS4, it's. Tends to be about 100 milliseconds sometimes, but it is what it is.
You guys developed your own engine for this game.
Yes.
Was that a guiding principle from the beginning? Was it just something that, for practical reasons, was easier to do? I mean, it's obviously all work, but, you know.
There's multiple good reasons to do that. Like, as a studio, if you want to have a long-term life as a game studio, it's just helpful to have this asset that you built on that you don't have to keep paying people for and that you have control over. Like, if a certain aspect of the experience is important for us to nail, right, we can rewrite any part of the engine.
As deep as you need to dig.
Yeah, and again, like I said, I want to make this game available to people 20, 10, 20, 30 years from now, right?
Sure.
20 years from now, I don't even know what platforms exist, but I know we'll be able to make this run on them because we completely own the source code. We don't have to port.
Yeah.
If you use something like Unreal, you know, it's really hard to port for reasons that may have nothing to do with your game because it's a big engine with all this stuff in it, right?
And
it's
you just know, like, if we're talking 20 years down the line, like who even knows? Will Unreal Engine exist? You know, will there?
But I'm saying, even in the best possible case, where you got a source license like into indefinite future, it still may be overwhelming, right? Mm-hmm. So it's all that stuff. That said, also when we started this game, because it was so long ago, engines that you could license were not multi-purpose and generally, you know, good as they are now. So
I cannot understand the idol discussing religion.
The choice might be a little different. If we are honest, you know.
Yeah. So, as you said, you know, it was kind of near the end of Braid. You kind of started forming the ideas for The Witness. Do you know what you're going to do next? Do you have an idea?
I have ideas. I've got several ideas, and we're sort of doing pre-production on a couple of them. And
but you're looking to keep the team together and keep going.
Yeah. It's a financially successful game, so we have the choice to do that, right? And I would like to because, man, if anything, like putting a game studio together with people who are good is hard, you know. And it's just it's nice to be able to.
Almighty God helps us in any way. What I do see.
Continue on with that. And I mean, the people that we have at the studio are great. They're highly skilled people. We built this giant game with a small team, which is hard. It took a while, right? But it's like being able to make this game at all is kind of amazing that anyone could, right? Just because there's so much stuff in it. So I'm really proud of the team, actually, and I'm glad.
And being able to take like that amount of time with it as well, and not have to compromise and ship in 18 months or something like that.
Yeah. So,
but that said, do you envision what you do next? Do you feel like you're signing up for another 7 or 8 years?
No. we would like to do a game that is reasonably complex, but I would like it to.
See what I'm saying here.
Well. There's several ways to speed up development, right? So one is just start with an engine, because, you know, like I said, developing your own engine, I think, is a good idea. It also does take time, right? And so we want to make something that exploits what this engine has been built for. So a first-person game where you're wandering around some environment, like something like that would be, we could do that faster than if we did something totally different, probably. Although, first-person is the hardest thing, so who knows. If we did like a third-person or like an isometric game, it might go faster, but then we're not using all the technology that we have.
Right. So you have to extend your existing technology.
Yeah, so there is that. And then,
he says the thing about natural processes. He starts to outline an actual philosophy.
Interesting.
I mean, there's just so many factors to weigh, right? On this game, it was not only that we programmed an engine, but I did a lot of the engine programming, right? While also being the main bottleneck on design. Like, I designed most of the puzzles, like I said, I was the person responsible for the experience and all that. Now, I think it's very important for designers to program, but if I restrict my programming to like more spare time kinds of things and occasional kinds of things, and other people do the main programming, then I spend more of my time designing, and that works. And then also, if we grow a little bit, that's a good way to go faster. I don't think you want to grow hugely, because it's very hard to manage that. But if we put all these things together, we should be able to do the next game a lot faster. But who knows, right?
I mean,
I went back and looked at that preview that Ryan wrote after he went to your apartment, and it said something like the game would be out in 18 months.
Yes.
Or something like that. And that was 5 years ago.
Yeah. So. But again, that isn't exactly because, I mean, part of that is always things take a little longer than you expected, but the game that we said would be out in 18 months is much smaller than the one that we built, and the one that we built is much nicer looking, and we didn't imagine that we would be able to do all this stuff. Like, I just, when I started, like I said, when I had that idea for the spellcasting game and then turned it into this, I was like, well, of course it's going to be a kind of a crappy looking indie game. Think about what a 3D indie game looked like in 2008, right?
Yeah.
I was thinking, oh, it's that.
The bar was very different then.
Yes.
For sure.
And I'm amazed that we were able to do this, actually. But it was like, we just kept seeing what we could do, and it was like, let's keep going. Mm-hmm. Let's make it good.
Do you have... You know, so there, I mean, what, I guess 12-ish different kind of themes for puzzles in the game.
Yeah.
Are there any just total types that are cutting room floor? Like let's say, if you were to say, like, oh, let's actually just make an expansion for The Witness, or let's actually try to make another game like The Witness. Do you already, are there puzzle types that didn't make it into this game at all that you would be able to use as a starting point? Or do you feel like you really wrung everything there is to wring out of this format?
You had a screenshot of that?
Yes. Okay. This was well, I just screwed up the shortcut. Yeah, here, this was my method using the PS4, because you can double tap back and forth.
Oh, I didn't know about
between
that.
Between screenshot and
that's
game.
Cool.
And it became a super useful reference point, but also also I wanted to turn this thing back on so I could ask you something about it, but please go ahead.
I think I know what it is, but...
yeah, I was also going to ask if you just remembered it.
Anyway, we were talking about what? Sorry, I got distracted by this.
Were there other types of puzzles?
Oh yeah, types of puzzles. There were a bunch, but they usually... usually what happened was I started out with some idea, and that idea changed several times and eventually became what's in the game now,
right,
which is not really that related to the original idea. But, you know, like the treehouse thing now has to do with, like, at most grouped with one other thing of its own color, or must be grouped with one, you know.
Right.
But it used to be like at most, or like even number of symbols, or has to be by itself with no other symbol. Like, I tried all of these things.
Yeah.
And it didn't, none of those were as good.
Right.
And then eventually you find the one that's good, right? Or the ones that are now the, you know, the square shaped pieces. Originally that was more like just counting how many spaces were in that shape, but it could be any shape.
Okay.
But not only did that not generate puzzles that were that great, but also, it just felt a little too much like counting all the time, which I didn't. I like the spatial feeling of the more shaped version. So that kind of thing happened a bunch. Since we're totally like free fire zone on spoiling environmental stuff already, there's only one environmental puzzle that didn't make it into the game. And it was one of the early ones in the early concepts of the game, which was you're going to go into a room. There's going to be like a long horizontal window where the light comes in. And there was going to be like a blobby, reflective, like chrome sculpture, or maybe a series of them that do different things. But the chrome sculpture was going to like blow out part of the line into a circle because it's like the curvature of the sculpture.
Oh, wow.
So it was going to be all about walking until the thing lands on the right piece, which would have been super cool. Mm. The thing is, in computer graphics, what you end up doing is estimating in real-time computer graphics that are not ray traced. You end up estimating that reflection off a chromed thing by like a point at the center of it versus the actual shape.
Right.
And so the thing that we had to design was wrong enough and weird enough that I didn't want to do it. It like didn't feel good.
Yeah.
I've got a zillion questions and I'm going to have to restrain myself here, but was it tricky at all? Like interacting with the actual puzzles, obviously, like it's a very defined shape.
Yeah.
Probably relatively easy to develop this interface, but when you're kind of abstracting the same concept into more organic shapes, or, you know, like kind of interacting with things where you're not looking at them front on all the time, like, was it tricky to kind of handle this stuff?
Detect like when it should work and when it
shouldn't? Yeah, like in terms of basic input, you know, it's like, oh, that circle's not, it's not quite enough of a circle to allow me to, and in fact, you even got this kind of guide.
That came in later in development, but it's very important. It's important to give people some feedback, right?
Yeah. Is it kind of like, it's like, oh, this is just not quite enough of a circle to allow the input?
Yeah, and in fact, there's sort of a hot cold on that particle feedback where you'll get fewer and fewer particles as you go further from the right spot. Sometimes that's tuned more forgivingly than other times and whatever, but... you know, yeah, we did a lot with these. You know, there's 130 of these, or roughly. I don't know the exact number, right? So, and they all came in later. You know, like I said, we had 12 or something early on, and then all of those broke because we were focusing on just getting the rest of the game put together and moving. Anytime we move anything on the island, we break several of these, right? Because, like, they're so, not only are they about where things are in the environment, but they often involve far away things or, you know, even like, hey, my tone mapping is different in this place because there's more trees surrounding it, so I can see the thing or not, right? So all that took a great deal of tuning. And yeah, there's a lot of little arts to it. Like, we want it to be not totally confusing, usually, about roughly where you would stand to start, if you know what you're looking for, right? And then hopefully, you can sort of figure out where to go. And in some cases, it's obvious, hopefully, that you can't get where you need to go. Like, you can see that there's a thing there, but like, I need to get up maybe or whatever.
It's like, okay, well, how do I actually get to where,
Yeah, and a lot of that is just about tuning for that particular puzzle, right?
Okay.
And by the way, one of the main factors of the art style, which people probably never think about consciously, is no circles allowed, right? If you think about how many circles are in the real world,
right. Yeah.
We never can have a circle in this game unless it's a puzzle clue, right?
Oh, believe me, I've been noticing more circles in the real world lately.
Yeah, that was great on Twitter, like just in the days after release, people posting photos of everything under the sun, you know?
So there's like mine carts in this game and stuff. Mm. And you'll note, if you go look at the wheels, which would normally be circles, they're actually this weird, you know, blobby triangle shape that actually has a constant diameter. Oh. And so the fiction is that they ride smoothly on these non-round wheels, and we designed it so that it would work.
So we
were serious about the no circle thing.
Yeah. Well, you kind of have to be.
And again, any circle could be a red herring about the environmental puzzles, right? And so we had to be very serious, you know. I don't know. I don't want to get too repetitive on that
sure.
point.
So, Jeff, this is kind of point of no return if I open this up.
Yeah, I mean, we told people at the beginning.
I'm saying in terms of if you want me to go out and see anything else on the island.
No, let's go ahead.
So my other thing was, and I'm sure you must have considered this, it's not like it would have taken you by surprise, but it must not bother you, but I feel like if I were in your shoes, like the thing behind this seems like the last thing you want people to see in the game. But it's possible, and this is how I found it, to just start a new file and get in there within 30 seconds of starting the game. So,
but did you do that on your first play? Or did
No. I hadn't actually quite. But it was a unique circumstance.
Now it is possible to never have played this game and go like, oh, that's weird, and do that.
Somebody on one of our users sent me a message the day the game came out asking if I had found this because because he found it as soon as he started the game.
But it's probably a low probability thing, and I think if you do find it, then cool, it means you observe some stuff, and that's in line with the game, right?
Okay, so you're not put out if people find that immediately?
It was important to me to not be pedantic about forcing it to be the last thing.
Okay.
So sort of what goes on is, you know, you start opening up those obelisks, and you can maybe, if you've filled out enough of those that you know that they're a map to things, it might lead you to look at this, and then you're like, that's a really weird shape, and I see how this could work, but it's turned off, so you could start a new game at that point, right? Or you could, keep going until you find that note that you had the screenshot of.
Andrew Lackey. Anthony Jimenez, Jeff Garnett.
But neither of those requires you to do all the other puzzles. It's just you maybe need to do enough of them to know how they go, and then notice that that's one of them.
Right.
And then the rest is if you want to be completionist, you know.
Sure.
Yeah.
Now I'm kicking myself because I actually wanted to go look at the lake and ask you about some of that stuff.
Well, you could load your old.
Yeah. In terms of the way that it tracks, I don't know. Do we have time?
Totally.
You got a meeting or anything? No. Where's the, I guess.
This is just on the internet, right? So on the internet, you can be as long as you want.
Definitely. It's 22 minutes.
Yep. And then,
we'll be back after these messages.
Go to commercial.
Yeah.
I mean, that was like, you know, even after finishing the game, I hungered for there to be more, you know? I wanted there to be other layers of things to discover.
That's the great thing. And also a little bit like, I don't even know what else we could
do.
We put so much stuff in this game. We worked for so many years to put this much stuff.
No, it's not enough.
And then, everybody's asking, like, are these numbers it? Is there any single other panel in the game?
Can I reduce the number of years you spent on this to these three numbers? Is that?
But it's also like, how isn't there more, sort of? And it's like, on the one hand, that's very gratifying. Like, wow, they played all that and they want more. But it's also like, I don't know how I could have possibly put more things in this game.
Do you feel part of that is because of what was in Braid? There's a bit of an expectation.
But that is in this, right? I feel like what's in this is bigger in terms of proportion of the game.
I agree with you having finished it now, but that was very much my thought process, reviewing the game in a vacuum when there was no information on the internet to look up. Because I remembered like the cloud puzzles and like the weirder, higher level stuff in Braid, and like I never even touched that stuff, you know. I finished the game and then moved on, and I was this game has similarly just layers upon layers of stuff.
But also though, I think, and one of the reasons why we didn't put like a reviewer guide saying that stuff is, like I said, intentionally all that stuff is designed. Like, it's not secret unless it's really secret. Right. Like, you have to be able to play the game plausibly and not ever see it, right? Mm-hmm. And so that is a valid experience for people to have. And so you can't, like, go into it designing it and say, well, it's only a good game if you find all this stuff, right? So, you know, earlier I said, well, a lot of reviewers didn't find that stuff. On the one hand, it's like, okay, well, maybe I wish more had. But on the other hand, that's totally reasonable because you should.
People will, you know, and if they didn't find it, like, you know, that's...
Then that's their experience of the game, right? And, yeah, so now I think, that said, given that reviews are on a deadline, it's probably more likely to not find that stuff within that deadline.
You're probably right.
You know... I don't know. It's a tangent.
I may have
we just put so much secret stuff in this game.
Oh, no, okay. I thought I might have screwed myself. I loaded an earlier save when there's not much in that lake to look at, but...
With all the lasers and line stuff, there should be...
Yeah, totally.
Like, you've probably done the elevator and all that.
Yes,
right?
Yes, on this save. Most of the stuff in the lake should at least be worth looking at.
Oh, that's
at this
a thing.
Point,
the stuff that changes in the lake in response
to
the elevator...
Yes.
That was, like, the week before ship.
Really?
You did that. Yeah.
I'm trying to remember the timeline of, like, I was talking to another reviewer at another site who was the one who tipped me off to the lake being kind of like a progress tracker of sorts.
Yeah.
Where am I? Is it this way?
Yep.
And I think it seems like it's all pretty much well understood at this point.
I'm
collectively
sure.
Collectively on the internet.
It's not that hard to figure. Once you know what the lake is.
Some of them are very evident, yeah. Like, you know, that obviously corresponds to a specific type of puzzle. Like, those look like the... laser boxes.
Yeah. So, I mean, I haven't read any of these, and I'm sure people have figured it out.
Right.
You know.
Is that, I mean, you're not here to tell us anything that we don't already know, but...
Yeah.
Is there more to any of this? Or, like, at a certain point, everything about this game will be known at a certain point, I guess.
I mean, like I said, it's a hard question to answer because I don't know exactly what people have...
Yeah.
Have found, but...
I mean, I've seen kind of pretty exhaustive breakdowns of, like, well, the fountains mean this, and the boxes are this, and, you know, the leaves mean so-and-so.
Yeah, I mean, I feel like it is known, right?
Yeah.
But I don't know if people are missing a few small things.
Mm-hmm. And you don't want to contribute new information.
Right, if there is anything else.
It's not my role to do that.
Sure,
you
sure.
know, I mean, I could have put a little
They'll have
fairy
to buy
in the game
Prima
saying,
guide
hey, Link, did you look around the corner?
Yeah.
What?
How did I never get this? Man! I should play some more of this game.
Well, that's not on your other saves.
No, yeah, I'll have to go do that again at home.
So the video that was replaced.
Brad,
you want to go back to the
sure.
laser field and
sure.
and get in there?
Yeah,
that was... Like you said, it seemed like, you know, people were playing the game for review, and then a patch hit that, like, the notes were like, put in all the final VO and video stuff.
Yeah.
Was that something that was, like, by design from the get-go, you just knew you were going to have to do work up to the end? Or was it like, okay, I'm not happy with this thing, we need to change it?
It was more like, you know, because I said I kept being unsatisfied with exactly what the story was,
mm-hmm.
or exactly at what level of presence it was gonna be there in. You know, we didn't start voice recording until like October or November.
Okay.
Maybe November, and then I wanted to do a good job. I didn't, like some games, go into the studio and they do a couple sessions and that's it, man.
Yeah.
And it was like, no.
And if something changes, you gotta make sure the game fits to these,
So we did auditions with everybody, or real auditions with a bunch of all very high quality candidates, got the right people, did a full just like practice session with everybody where we sent them scripts in advance and just like hung out and talked over what everything meant and all that, because it's not light material, so you've gotta, it's better when people understand the material. So we actually also selected for people who would understand, like part of the audition process was like, tell us what you think about these subjects, you know?
Right, yeah.
Do you happen to remember the solution, or should I look it up again?
It's 3-2-1 going down.
Oh,
it's
like I thought it was 1-2-3. That's
it's 3-2-1.
Great, thank you. Sorry to interrupt.
No problem. So you know, and then we did a couple of sessions to get all the voice together, including for the dialogues. The dialogues are the ones that really came in hot. Like, we had some final recordings for the other stuff in that thing. But, it was my... And we had recordings for most things. Apart from those little story ones, we had temp voice sessions from the earlier sessions. So it was like, look, if you're going to score us lower based on some random piece of temp voice being a little lower quality, that's fine, whatever. Either you dig what the game is doing or you don't. So sure. I felt like it was reviewable. But it was just, I started that process so late, you know. It was a 6 or 7 year development, and I started that with 4 months to go.
Well, that
it's crazy that we got it done by the ship date.
That was a super weird moment for me because I found this area, I think of it as like the credits hotel or whatever, but I found this area the morning of the day that the PS4 patch went out. So I got in here before.
So it was before release.
So I heard you in what sounded like a broom closet reading
the credits.
But it led me to wonder if that was actually like a stylistic decision. It's like, what is he trying to say with this? Because I had no idea that was coming.
What does it say about the nature of the island?
I didn't know that voices were going to get updated in a patch, so it was it was
those were easily the worst recordings in the pre-patch.
I feel like we've come this far, we might as well run all the way to the end.
And then this bit was different pre-patch.
This was also different.
We did the final filming of this like 4 days.
There was
Twitter documentation of you looking for props.
Is this just a video that you jog back and forth like a panning shot?
We had someone who's in the credits come to the office and lay down a track and her and her assistant did a bunch of runs. Mm-hmm. We did runs with the thing, the lights off and lights on because you can turn the lights off and on with this panel. And I had to hold my breath the whole time, and it took like a minute. And it's not that hard the first couple times, but after 15 takes, it gets harder to hold your breath. And so I'd screw some up. And then it's actually not the same. There's somebody else in this scene. Let me put it that way. It's not me, actually. So that was interesting because we got to trade off and stuff.
This is a super neat effect.
Yeah.
All right.
That was actually part of the original concept of the game when I had the idea. It was like in the first couple of months, it was like, all right, at the end, you're going to go down this hallway and we're going to do this trick where there's a scene from real life that seems weird because the image sense in a video is so different than the game.
Yeah.
So we actually managed to do that, which was kind of crazy.
Yeah.
I feel like there's only one way to end this, and it's talking about that jug.
You must. I don't understand why.
It took on a life of its own.
It really did.
We never talked about the statues, but I guess we should just move on.
I expected it to be a little dumb joke.
Yeah.
And I guess it had that mystique of like people thinking it was maybe real or something.
We had the context of having seen it and going like, oh, okay, that's from, the, okay, this
we
makes were, sense.
I was, so I, yeah, we saw you, tw- so I, we saw the pre-patch version of this video. Did it? Oh, here it goes. We saw the pre-patch version of this video Thursday morning before release.
Yeah.
You tweeted that photo. I went back there after the patch that afternoon.
And saw the video.
Watched the full thing. Yeah. Jeff was standing there watching the video behind me, and it'll come up in a minute, and he was just like, oh yeah, he just tweeted a photo of that a few minutes ago. And then, like, then all of Twitter lost its mind over that thing.
It's totally in the video.
And we were sitting there because we were still under embargo, just like screaming internally, going like, "It's in the game. You don't understand. Like this thing you're all losing your minds over
is ashamed
in the game.
Of your words and deeds when you know what the jug means."
Someone tweeted that, and I actually retweeted that. And I was gonna say it, but then I was like people would take that a little too far.
Yeah.
So I just let it ride. So this was fun. We filmed this the weekend before we had to submit certification for the patch, So the main game was already in cert.
Right.
And this was like, you know, whatever Tuesday or Wednesday you guys got the patch, this was like Monday.
Mm-hmm. Because I think people figured out it was that Sunday night you had been tweeting asking about tubes or whatever. Yeah.
So did this end up kind of being the last act, like the last bit of development, or I mean, you know, discounting
pretty
kind
much,
of PC patches,
pretty,
and
pretty
stuff
close,
like that.
Yeah. I mean, it was then fiddling with compression to try and make small and color correction and stuff.
Why is it 4x3?
Because it was shot on a GoPro, and then I didn't want to clip it any more than it was.
Oh wow. I think the placeholder video was 16x9, if I remember.
Yeah, because that was shot on an iPhone or mm-hmm. something. I did a lot of different experiments with different stuff strapped to my head. So, it was fun. It was a good time. This was a little bit of a stressful session because we didn't have the, like, people were going to come in and work at like 10, 30, or 11. Someone from the press was going
to
come visit the office.
Oh, wow. So we had to be done by.
Yeah. No, we managed like 4 takes or something, and this was the best take.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Do you give any kind of like specific credibility to people who say like, you know, like, oh, this implies the whole island was a dream, or like you had electrodes hooked up to your head and like thought the code or whatever?
I stayed away from reading that kind of stuff on the internet, in part because we've been really busy just doing support for people, and because like on the PS4 you don't really need that much support because it's a stable platform and all that, but on the PC, man, it's crazy. Yeah. So that's been my entire job since the game came out, and almost everybody's entire job.
Right. Is there a lot left to, or do you feel like there's a lot left to do there in terms of?
It's getting reasonable. Yeah. But now
I saw you were out buying video cards.
Oh God,
through all
so
that.
So we've been
stuff.
Doing all that video card stuff, and now we're at the point of like, okay, we're getting some features in that would be good to have. Like, okay, we just patched in like a reticle for people who are getting motion sick and stuff, which I didn't really know that was as much of a thing as it is. But had I known, we would have shipped it. So we're just starting to do that kind of stuff. Maybe I'll patch in that the trigger makes you turn faster. But you know, the game is for the most part done, so we're not going to be patching in like extra content, right?
Yeah.
Tell us about your season pass.
Yeah, it's not going to be anything like that.
Yeah.
And then we'll be bringing it to new platforms for a bit.
Okay. Yeah. iPad, is that the only other announced platform?
That
right
is
now?
The only other announced platform. There's some other ones we're thinking of seriously. Mm-hmm. So I wouldn't be surprised to see at least 3 other platforms this year. But but that all depends on how well it goes. Like, we might do feasibility on one, and we're just like, oh, this is going to be a nightmare. Let's not do this one. So that's the only reason why we don't announce yet.
I was surprised to see the kind of click-to-move interface on the PC. Should that be taken as kind of a template for how the iPad version might work in terms of controls and stuff?
Well, I don't believe that's enabled currently.
Oh, is it not?
If you got the beta pre-ship, was enabled.
Okay.
But it wasn't done. We were hoping to finish it, right?
Okay.
It's not really usable yet. But yeah, that's actually the next big feature I want to ship on PC, is that works, which then, you know, like some people, their family, your mom wants to play it or something, and mouse and keyboard is kind of challenging if you're not a gamer, right? Mm. So we want to have a click-to-move mode.
Yeah, like I think my mom would actually super enjoy this game, but I don't know that she could grapple with the controls.
And then once those technical underpinnings are there, that'll be useful for stuff like iPad, right?
Because
when you tap on something far away, the game has to do some good pathfinding and stuff to go there. Yeah.
Cool.
So, and pathfinding in first person is harder because in third person, if things turn a little weird or whatever, it's not a big deal, or especially if your camera's detached from the thing. But
sure, but if it's
when your camera's on it, it's a totally different.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And you know, I guess, but at least you have the benefit of like, you know, it's not a game where you're jumping off of cliffs and like, you know, there is kind of a set path there.
Yeah, yeah.
To some extent. So
we'll see how that goes.
Cool.
But I hope it goes well.
All right. Well, I guess we should let you get back to it.
I got no shortage of things to do. Yeah. Thanks for having me on.
Yeah, absolutely. Thanks for coming by.
It's nice to just be able to talk about the game. First of all, you know, because we're far enough past release that we can just say whatever. But also, I appreciate that this format is like not so canned as some things are, and we're just like chilling and talking. Like it's nice, right?
We try to relax.
Yes.
Yeah.
We spend a lot of years very much not relaxing. I realize like, there's a better way to do this stuff, so or at least we think so. So
right on. Yeah.
Thanks a lot
for having me on.
Yeah, absolutely.
All right, and thanks everybody for watching. That's The Witness. Look forward to The Witness Season Pass DLC coming any day now.
As soon as this
video's over, it'll be
to solve the right puzzle in the game, and the second island will appear. That's why the water is so. The inverted island.
Yeah. I'm gonna get 200.6% finally.
I don't know. Should we say something? Because the video. No. Do we want the video to end? No.
I know. We're almost there.
Let's play through the end of the video.
This was kind of fun, actually.
Until you reach true enlightenment here. Yeah.
It's almost like a scene in a first-person game where you see the arms, and I was intentionally like reaching a little further than you would naturally because
to give it that look.
Yeah. Yeah. Actually, before the infamous jug, the thing that I tweeted was a pair of glasses with like some tape on them and holes. Yeah. And I wore those for this video so that when I looked around, the camera would track, right? Because otherwise, you look at things like just moving your eyes. Mm-hmm. So.
Yeah, it's a hard, yeah.
Yeah, so I wanted to track, and that's how I got this feeling. Mm-hmm. Anyway. I don't know if it's that's me or if it's post.
Your out back looks very relaxing.
Yeah.
At your
it's nice. It's nice. We may move eventually because what you saw is the size of our office. So if we grow it all, it's kind of too small.
Yeah, how are you going to fit?
Is that, that looks like a residential space, though. Is it like a loft?
It sort of
or
is
something?
Like the two above us are our residences, and then the bottom used to be an antique furniture store.
Okay. Well, yeah, you do, you're right. You do have that.
Not exactly more, antique, but like classy. Yeah.
I guess you do have that kind of industrial-looking bathroom in there, so it's not a full-on apartment or anything. Yeah. But
I always wanted to get an industrial bathroom in my house, though. I thought that'd be kind of cool. Just have high pressure,
the drain in the floor, so you just spray it down.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah.
Well. All right. Again, thanks for your time.
Sure. Yeah.
And that's the witness. That's all there is to know, right?
That's everything.
You have witnessed.
Yeah.
Now.
Thanks, everybody. See ya.
Yeah.